Welcome, everyone. This is Carl with Insider, along with Wayman McAllister from Insider. Welcome to Petty Perspectives inside the Insider Tribune. Hope you guys are doing great. This is episode 3. Welcome to Wayman McAllister, my friend.
Thank
drummer,
you.
Drummer extraordinaire in the band.
Appreciate you, Carl.
We've had so much fun
playing
and getting to know the songs and all that. It's just, it's been a real pleasure to get to know you because we didn't know each other before this band.
That's true.
And so it's been it's been really fun to get to know you and you know, listen and watch you, your style and your ability behind the kit, because it's very unique, and we'll talk about that later. But
appreciate that.
Oh yeah, why don't you just start a little bit with like maybe your background, what got you started in drums?
I decided I wanted to be a drummer in middle school, and the band director couldn't talk me out of it. No, you know, there's 13
no
of us that signed up for drums and band.
Yeah,
and,
no denying it.
And I said, you know, this is for me, and made my way to the A-list, and started out with the rock and roll. That's what I got in it for,
right.
Of course, is to play the trap kit, and the rest is history. I mean, I just always was a big, big music guy. Before that, in middle school or in elementary school, I was selected to play bongo drums on a fifth grade choir recording.
Right.
And I have no idea why I was selected for that. I still have the vinyl album.
Okay.
I went back and listened to it. I uncovered it recently, and it's not very good. but it put me on a course. And
that's what it's about.
Right.
Good deal. Well, we are here this evening at Beam Live at 50 Penn Place. Wayman McAllister is the proprietor here. Why don't you tell us about Beam Live and where we are? We got the man right behind us here.
This is
Mr. Petty himself.
Yes, one of Mr. Rick George's prints. We have them all throughout the club, and it was another sign that this was kind of in my future when he was looking for a home for his prints. And we've got the Rolling Stones, we've got all of these rock icons and beautiful caricatures. He's the lead guitarist for Uncle Zeb, so yeah. He performs here regularly. I work with them.
You've done a great job. This is my first time being
in
here since the previous theme, or
yeah.
You know, you want to call it. It's been great. A total redo, painting, decor, lighting. You guys
yes.
need to come out here, hopefully to see us, but also to see other bands.
We'll be right here.
Yeah.
February 24th.
Oh, cool. That's right. Yeah, February 24th. We will be here in this building, back where it all started.
That's right. This is where we first cut our teeth.
That's right. Our first gig as Insider was right here.
Yeah.
So we're happy to come back.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
We weren't even named at that point.
That's
we didn't have a name for the band.
The guys.
Yes.
Playing Tom Petty music.
Yes. I had originally approached Neil about Cheap Trick because I knew
right.
he was a big fan.
Right.
Neil and I go way back to a previous century,
mm-hmm.
actually,
yep.
and he was always near and dear to my heart as a guitarist and a vocalist, and I knew he was a Cheap Trick fan, but they had been doing some Bellevue reunion shows, and every time they played a Petty song, the crowd just went nuts.
Yeah.
And so he said, nah, let's try Petty, and
yeah.
I was all on board with that.
Yeah, well, it's worked out, thankfully. It's been, I think we're on year 7 right now.
Okay.
Almost 8.
Yeah, we're approaching 8.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, it's been fun.
It's a wild ride.
Yeah. Well, why don't you tell me, I mean, we all have our stories of how we got to know, I mean, it was all over the FM radio and all over MTV, you know, and we're kind of second generation, kind of Tom Petty, as far as living, you know, when we're growing up, it was kind of in the second half, I'd say, of his career. We missed the early, you know, the late 70s kind of stuff, but.
It was Damn the Torpedoes, and I might have been approaching a teenager, so still very young, but already a huge Beatles fan,
okay.
Eagles, you know, just definitely into the top 40 format. And I saw this guy that put out this incredible album, and he had, you know, black fingernail paint, and it, you know, just looked a little different and sounded definitely different. And he was just always in a class by himself. There was something very unique. He didn't sound like all the other artists, and I know originally the journalist community and the critic community had trouble pinpointing exactly what he was.
Where to put him.
He was pegged as post-punk and all of these things, and maybe there was some of that early on, but it just intrigued me, and you know, more than anything else, just these songs. Oh my God, Refugee, and Don't Do Me Like That, and then just the rest of the album, every single song, you know, and, even The Losers is still one of my top three favorite songs by him, so just great music, just
having an
appreciation for that at an early age.
What's fun is I have a very good friend who graduated high school in the late 70s. He's a little bit older than us, but so I can only imagine that time of the music coming out at that point to us, like the point when, you know, his kind of partnership with Jeff Lynne was going on, because we were, I was still in high school when Full Moon Fever came out, but that was so huge. And so I always asked my friend, what was that like when those huge hits came out in the late 70s? Because it was so new.
Yes.
It was really just so many.
And caught on in Europe first.
Yeah.
Right. America didn't know what to do with it. Yeah. It was huge over there.
Right.
It's funny because you look at your memories, which is a big part of our lives, obviously, and you just remember where you were and what you were doing and all those things. But now, in retrospect, looking back at Petty's career and his catalog, I see him as kind of the premier Americana artist, right? Like legendary rock icon version of Americana.
Right.
And throughout, despite the different producers and the different sounds created on their albums and the tracking and everything, that's really where I think his essence is.
Yeah. I just love the changes that they go through. And every band has changes, right? But you look at the pop mega hits, right? Like The Waiting.
Yes.
Right? And you get those, and you get Free Fallin'.
Right.
Right? You get these pop mega hits. And then a little bit later, you get albums like Mojo.
Right.
Which are straight up blues rock.
Yes.
And like what they played when they were teenagers.
Right.
Right. The
exactly.
Things they learned. And then a little bit later on the last few albums, more pop.
Right.
And kind of mix the two. It just, it amazes me the deeper I go in the catalog. When we pull out something like what was the song you mentioned earlier, that's still one of your favorites.
Oh, Even the Losers.
Even the Losers.
Yeah.
It was a hit,
yeah,
but not a mega hit.
No, that's right.
And we play that and people's faces light up.
They do.
You know,
the diehard fans love to hear.
I love that.
Something a little different.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, folks, we got a few segments here with Wayman. You know, we do every week here, we do a discussion topic, and we have a instrument or gear of the week, and we also have song of the week. So we're going to roll through those here, and we're going to get Wayman behind the kit, I think, and maybe show us a little bit about what is going on with what he does back there up on stage, because, you know, he's back there behind the fortress of drums, and so we're going to give you an inside look at all that. So here we come to the next segment. All right, we have Wayman behind the kit. We're here.
It's happening.
You're in your world. All right, folks, the topic of the week today is drums and percussion and how Wayman integrates those in a set. This is really cool because you don't just play the kit, do you?
Well, we want all the bells and whistles we can in these songs, including what was on the original tracks, and so I try to incorporate some of the other you know, tambourine, cowbell, where appropriate.
Okay. So let's start with one. What do you want to start with?
Let's go easiest first.
Okay, cowbell. I got a Fiva.
That's right. You got it, Christopher Walken. This is on the Wilbury song.
Okay.
Handle yep. with care.
Handle with care. Yep.
And when we get to the chorus, we do Lance's part, the Roy Orbison part, and then we get into the everybody needs somebody.
Yeah.
So I just slide over here. Everybody got somebody. I sing the low,
that's
messy
great.
Bob Dylan yep. part.
That is good.
But yeah, it makes a big difference just to hear that other instrument introduced into the,
yep.
you know, into
so,
the layers.
Why don't you play the transition, how you go from the verse or a chorus into that that part.
Yeah, it's a very simple drum beat. It's just
right.
four on the floor.
Okay.
So actually, two on the floor, I guess. And then the other one, another Wilbury song. I've got the trusty tambourine stick.
The tambo stick.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so you guys hit your acoustic intro.
Right.
And before we come in, it's a little.
Yeah.
It's all right. I try to mute it because it only plays during certain other parts of the song.
Okay.
So it's really kind of horizontal.
Okay.
Get a little of
yeah.
music effect, and then when it really kicks in.
Turn
it up right, and
I
you
see.
Get that.
So you're able to control that while you're holding both of them together.
Yes.
And you can control the...
Yes. Finally, there is You Got Lucky, which I incorporate this guy, and the pattern changes throughout the song.
Okay.
So sometimes it's every other four, sometimes it's two and four, sometimes it sits out all together.
Yeah.
And so just with each section of the song kind of dictates what you do there, but...
There you go.
And then the chorus.
I see. That's cool. Again, I did not know you did that.
Well,
it's 100 decibels behind me.
Sure.
So
you do notice my drum fills, though.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I definitely do.
Which we talked about already.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's just great, Wayman. Folks, there's an insight to how Wayman integrates percussion with just the regular. He's busy enough already playing drums, but he is able to add in those little details that he's so good about doing. You're so good about that.
Thank you.
Finding the right thing at the right time.
Yeah.
And being able to integrate it while doing what you're already doing.
Which is what we're all doing to a certain
yeah,
extent,
to a certain
right?
extent,
we're,
yeah.
we're all covering multiple things and carrying our weight,
yeah.
each of our
yeah.
individual performances.
Well, that's great. That's a great insight to what goes on back here. All right, instrument of the week. And everyone is lucky to understand the world of the importance of a snare drum, because
yes.
not all snare drums are created equal.
That's
correct?
Right.
Yeah.
And often you'll find many different snare drums used on the same album for different songs.
Right.
And you're looking for different sounds. But this gal, Big Blue, is on loan from our guru. Lance Dierker. The drum kit itself is on loan from Neil, and they don't quite match up. They're both blue, but they get the sounds we want, which
right.
is important,
yes.
particularly the early 80s, Stan Lynch, ginormous
right.
arena rock sound.
Yes.
And this is a big drum. It's a regular 14-inch. I thought it was 8.5 deep, which is the kind of the defining characteristic, but it's actually 9.5 inches deep.
It's like a tom almost.
It is. It's built more like a tom, and then I have the double snare strand,
okay.
double wide,
yeah.
on the bottom, which gives it a little bit of extra crispiness in its place, in its element for Tom Petty music. It's especially in a place like the Diamond Ballroom or Cotillion in Wichita, it's just really sings.
It shines. And what do we call it? A puffy cloud?
That's right.
Yeah.
It's a puffy cloud. You got to have your coated ambassador here.
Yeah.
This head is not new. We'll see about replacing it before the show. But I call it too like a snowbank. You know, you just fall in and do snow angels. It's
right.
Just.
Yeah. Now, there's some snares that they're not as deep. That have more of a crack, more of an attack, right?
Yes.
Like a piccolo, and that's
correct.
A sound kind of like Chili Peppers or Stone Temple Pilots.
Spin Doctors,
yes. It has a lot of crack to
it.
And this doesn't have as much crack, but it has a lot more.
It's got the depth.
Kind of depth
yes.
to it.
Yes, it's more boomy.
There was a couple keys when we put the group together to really make it right. After the first show or two, when we said, okay, we're really going to do this.
Right.
Some of those biggies were, like, in my world, a Rickenbacker 12-string.
Yes.
Right? That was a huge
of course.
Kind of, if we're going to do this, we're going to need one.
That's right.
The other one was mm-hmm. this.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes. And, yeah, like you said, all the pieces came together. Some of it was already in our possession.
Yeah.
One or the other person had what we needed. But, yeah, we...
I think anyone who... is not already familiar with drums and the gear that goes along with it, wouldn't know any difference between, you know, any kind of snare drum. But if you listen to different types of snares, listen to the Stan Lynch, you know, the early first decade or two of Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and the snare sound like that is all over it.
These are all Ludwig. 80s models, 84, 85.
Okay.
I think Lance told me they changed to this is a rare badge here, signifying that these were still made in Chicago when at that time most of the manufacturing had moved to like North Carolina or somewhere.
Okay. Well, very cool. Folks, that's Instrument of the Week, Big Blue, the snare drum that defines the sound of this group. Okay, Song of the Week. We got Wayman here with the kit, with the snare, and there's really no other choice because of how tough this is to play throughout the whole song. Wayman plays this riff almost through the entire song, and it's not easy, and it's Don't Come Around Here No More. Huge hit off the Southern Accents album. Between the video and the song, it was so iconic.
Yes.
I mean, it was, everyone talked about it.
Right.
Right? It's kind of Alice in Wonderland type theme.
Yeah, it was a different style video and very innovative at the time.
Yeah.
But the drum beat is very unique, and it's a little bit easier for me to cover being a lefty and not having to cross.
Cross, yeah.
So the bass drum beat is... And my hand does get tired after about 4 minutes of that.
Yeah.
But then you incorporate the toms into it, and it's...
Yeah, that's so cool.
And that's it, the whole time.
The whole time.
And I'm ready for that last verse where we break it down, and I'm done with that.
Right.
But it is fun, and it's a challenge.
It is a huge moment when we start the song. You know, Alex holds that chord, holds that F on the keyboard, and Lance and I kind of, I play a little bit of the sitar, and he's going on his bass, and then you come in with the beat, right, with the riff, and everyone goes crazy.
As soon as Neil opens that
chest. It's such a cool moment because everything's kind of droney and quiet, and then you come in with that. And people know exactly what it is.
We're kind of easing our way into it.
Mm-hmm.
I think as soon as you hit the sitar, people know what they're in store for.
Maybe.
But we keep a real simple, no snare, you know, just little fills and stuff and
yeah,
chimes and cymbals. Mm-hmm. And then when the big moment arrives, we go right into that beat.
Yeah, just a cool song. I mean, collaboration with Dave Stewart from the Eurythmics.
Yeah.
I mean, he's in the video looking funky, you know.
And his influence on that song, you know, it's a different song even for Petty.
Very.
As diverse as his musical endeavors are, that song sticks out as just something a little bit funky, a little bit out there. And it makes sense that it's half of the Eurythmics that's partnering with him on that.
So cool.
Yeah.
Folks, that is Song of the Week, Don't Come Around Here No More, Southern Accents album. Go listen to the album, revisit it. There's a lot more songs on it, so take a listen to that.
That is it for episode 3 of Petty Perspectives Inside the Insider Tribute. I want to thank my good friend, Wayman McAllister. Wayman, it's been
my
so
pleasure.
Much fun. Man, I love doing this. I had so much fun with Neil and Lance. And now to do this, sit down with you and to have you behind the kit is really a great time.
Well, the talents of my bandmates never cease to amaze me. Who knew we had a Ken Burns in the group?
Well, hopefully these
documentarian.
Hopefully these videos are getting better. That's it for us. Let's update you on our upcoming gigs. We have a few coming up. So first is right here at Beam Live at 50 Penn Place, February 24th. So come on. Is there a place they can buy tickets?
Yes, showslinger.com. And of course, the event is up on our Facebook page, and you can hit the ticket link from there. Beam Live in Oklahoma City. It's all ages. It's non-smoking, reserve seating, VIP seating. We have a little dinner club vibe going on here, so you can still get food from downstairs, Belle Isle Restaurant. They've been great partners throughout this project, and it's going to be a big night.
Well, great. So February 24th here at Beam Live, what else we have coming up?
We'll have a few months break unless something comes up before then, which is always possible, but we'll be busy recording, I'm sure, and with other projects. But this summer, we have quite a slate lined up. June 21st is Legends in Chickasha.
Great venue. We played there once before.
We played there last year. Yeah. Fred does an amazing job down there. It's really... like a hard rock vibe.
He's got all the memorabilia he has on the walls is amazing.
Yeah, nice big stage, big room, great service as well. Yeah. You can eat dinner there.
Yep.
July 3rd is the Choctaw Casino in Durant. I forgot who we're performing after. Is it the Doobie Brothers?
Yes,
Brothers. So concert at the casino, Doobie Brothers, and then we'll be playing on the Gilly stage while people are filing out of there, and usually attract a big crowd that way.
Yes. Yeah.
And then July 13th and 27th, which is kind of unusual to have double booking in the same month at the same venue, but that's Marina Del Rey down on Lake Texoma. I believe it's Kingston, Oklahoma.
Kingston on the Oklahoma side.
Right.
Okay. Well, great. Well, that's where we're going to be, folks. So check us out. Look for us on our Facebook page, find us on our YouTube channel and subscribe to us and comment on videos and tell us about your experience at one of our shows. We really appreciate all you guys coming out. And I know you have a lot of options of what to do on Fridays and Saturday nights, and so we really appreciate you coming out to shows like this. All right, well, thanks a bunch. That's it for episode 3. Thanks again, Wayman.
My pleasure.
Next week, the man, Alex Blazy, blazing on the keys, the ukulele, the harmonica, the baritone guitar. He does it all.
Backup vocals,
all of it.
12-string.
That's right. So check us out next week with Alex, and we will see you on February 24th. Thanks, guys.